Hello, I'm Sheldon Morais, Eyewitness News online news editor, and I'm talking to Stephen Grootes today, 702 talk show host, political analyst, all-round nice guy, and EWN senior political reporter. He's also a man who's covered Jacob Zuma for 13 years. Get that right, 13 years, since 2005. Stephen, that's a long time to be covering one person. You obviously haven't only covered him, but for much of the time you've been focusing on Zuma the man, Zuma the president. Looking at where we are now, Zuma's out of office. How would you describe his presidency or his leadership over those 13 years?
I suppose where you'd need to start off with is that South Africa's been prey to a sort of big man politics, really, and very much big man. And Zuma has dominated our politics really since 2005. And that was the year when Shabir Sheikh, his financial advisor at the time, was found guilty of essentially paying Zuma a bribe. And since then, everything has been dominated by that. There was the, should he be removed as deputy president? He was by Thabo Mbeki. Then the fight back ended up culminating in Polokwane. He took over as leader of the ANC. And that, of course, gave him the point to dominate our politics. And he has ever since. I mean, long before state capture became a thing, many people were raising their hands and saying, Jacob Zuma is a problem for South Africa's politics because of the corruption charges he faces that emanate from the Sheikh trial. The ANC has got itself into an unfortunate position where, in this last election in Nasrec, it was really Ramaphosa, because he was anyone but Nkosazana Dlamini Zuma. Exactly the same thing happened in Polokwane. Jacob Zuma was the result of a dynamic that said anyone but Thabo Mbeki. And so all of it goes back in a way to Thabo Mbeki's actual rule.
Now, Stephen, you mentioned the Sheikh trial. We see how the Zuma presidency has ended with the cloud of the Guptas over him. You know, if we look at his relationship with business people, has that, I suppose, always been problematic?
Yeah, very much so. I mean, Shabir Sheikh was someone who kind of cozied up to Zuma. He basically was paying him a political retainer. And Judge Hilary Squires really found that their relationship, that there were major problems with it, and that it was actually about money changing hands. And the state brought strong evidence for that. In a way, one of the original sins of our politics, if you've got the arms deal, but the second was the political pressure that was used to remove the charges against Zuma just before the elections in 2009. It was about 10 days before that election. And when those charges were withdrawn against him by Mokotedi Mshe, and, you know, now being reinstated by courts left, right and centre, then you could see that Zuma was going to become president. And I think most people knew that we were actually in for trouble. I mean, there'd been a very damaging rape trial in 2006. And what you'd had since then was claim after claim about Zuma. I must say, it's hard to remember this now, and people won't believe it, but there was a small honeymoon period in 2009, just after he became president. He gave, in my view, the two best prepared speeches he's done in English, were when he, as ANC leader, accepted the results in 2009 at the Election Results Centre. And the second was at his first inauguration. He took the oath with Pius Lange, who was the Chief Justice at the time. And his speech then was really full of hope. I think the dashing of that hope came a few months later when he appointed Advocate Menzi Simelane as head of the National Prosecuting Authority. And Simelane had already been found to have lied under oath. And that was when we knew, I think, that there was very much trouble in store.
Stephen, looking at his presidency and those appointments, you know, we had the Menzi Simelane appointment. You talk about someone lying under oath. Des Van Rooyen, another of his appointments, you know, just recently being found to also have lied. Zuma made a number of questionable appointments. Were those all about protecting himself? What were they? I mean, looking back now.
I think for a long time there were two things that you would see. First, you would see someone who would support Zuma no matter what. So you saw that in various positions. Nati Mtetwa was Minister of Police, for example. Bheki Cele, who was someone who really supported him, was the National Police Commissioner. You saw that, and then you started to see something else. You started to see Zuma picking people with no constituency. Another easier way to put that would be people who are weak. If you don't have a constituency that will support you, you will do whatever your boss tells you. You will do whatever the person appointed you tells you to do. And Menzi Simelane was one of those. Some of those, of course, have rebounded on him. At one point, he needed to choose a chief justice. He chose what he thought at the time was perhaps the weakest constitutional court judge available, who was Judge Mokgweng Mokgweng, and that's rebounded on him very, very badly. Although I think one of Zuma's big missteps, one of his big mistakes, was, I think through ego, allowing Omar el-Bashir to come here. That made judges sit up and take notice. And I'm not saying that that clouded their judgment on Nkandla, but it might have informed the way they made sure the entire nation knew how they felt about Nkandla. The judges were woke. And I think what you have now over time, and what we've really begun to realize, partly through just more and more time passing, partly through the Guptas and the Gupta leaks, partly through books like Jacques Poe's The President's Keepers, it's actually something much more sinister. It is almost a parallel state where elements of the state, so the NPA, the State Security Agency, I mean, people use the word repurposed, but what they've really been done is they've been set up to help Zuma and to protect him. And so that's really what we've now started to see the evidence of. And that's also why removing Zuma has been so difficult.
Stephen, it's easy at this stage to you know, with the cloud of the Guptas and state capture and someone like Cyril Ramaphosa coming up, and you know, you mentioned the exposés, Jacques Poe's books and the Gupta leaks and whatever. But I have to ask, were the Zuma years all bad?
So the first term, and Greta Montashe actually put it quite well at Nasrec. He said that the first term was had some high points, but the second term almost certainly was. You know, the first term had certain things that occurred within it. There were, for example, the Soccer World Cup that was held here. So those things were seen as good things for South Africa. It was a sort of momentum the country had picked up that kept going despite Zuma's rule. I mean, I will never forget the sight of Jacob Zuma and Sepp Blatter on the pitch at the opening match. I'm thinking, I don't know if this is really going to make incredible TV. And it's interesting to look at what's happened to both of those men now. One's been completely defenestrated, and the other, I think, his reputation is in tatters. In fact, it all applies equally to both. So there were times, but all the time we knew that something was coming. I don't think we realized it would be quite this bad. I don't think people thought that, you know, he would try and almost sell the country for a nuclear deal. That still doesn't make sense. So in the second half, the first part of his first term, there was a little bit of optimism. There's a great Sapiro cartoon when he was under pressure to remove the shower head in his cartoons. And he actually drew a cartoon of Zuma trying to remove the shower head with a hacksaw and a screwdriver and all sorts of things. And eventually said, well, just maybe shape up. And the shower head did leave his head for a few times. We'll be somewhere else. But with Menzi Simelane's appointment, who came firmly back on. So I think, you know, one of the astounding things of South African politics is that Cyril Ramaphosa was accused of culpability in the Marikana massacre. 4 months after that massacre, he was elected deputy leader of the ANC. You know, cause and effect don't seem to be related to each other in our politics. So there were maybe one or two what I would call moderately bright spots. But by and large, I think South Africa is going to look over the last 10 years as a wasted decade. A decade of bad governance, of very poor education. A decade where there's solutions to our big problems like racialized inequality have not been, not been found, have not been sought. Land is still a major problem, and the issues around it and the tensions around it are quite understandably rising again because nothing's being done. All of this is a wasted 10 years of opportunity that we could have made the country much better than it is now.
Now, Stephen, a lot of people may not know this, but Jacob Zuma has been quite influential and powerful in the ANC even before his election as deputy president. In fact, he served as national chairperson for a while. How did this man become that strong to ultimately topple, ANC royalty in Thabo Mbeki? I mean, you know, for a lot of people before the Shabir Sheikh era, you know, he would have been a deputy president, he would have been there. But I get the sense that Zuma's power goes, you know, much beyond that. Is that the case?
Yeah, I mean, obviously he's been in the ANC for a very long time. He's the last president we'll have who served 10 years on Robben Island. And he was famously the founder of the Robben Island Chess Club at the time. So you have someone who's been in the ANC for a very long time. We shouldn't forget that in the early 1980s, I know reporters much older than me who used to refer to Mbeki and Zuma as the twins because they were always together. These were very close friends. They would have been people who would have crept under border fences into Swaziland and back again together. In a way, the story into the late 90s and early to mid-2000s was really the end of that relationship. You know, Broder Twist is a thing. And what you really started to see was the breakup of that dynamic with huge implications. I think the way that Zuma managed to do it, firstly, was that he He was part of the ANC and part of the National Executive Committee, I think even when Oliver Tambo was still leader. So his roots go back very far. He won power at Polokwane partly because of the way Mbeki had dealt with him. If Mbeki had never claimed that there was a plot against him by Cyril Ramaphosa, Matthews Poser, and Tokyo Sekhwale, I don't think Zuma would have become president. It all has its roots in that. That was Mbeki's big mistake. Mbeki's other big mistake was to appoint Bulelani Yang'luka as head of the NPA, because he then misstepped and was too aggressive against Zuma, and that's what allowed Zuma to get off the hook. But all in all, for me, the roots of Zuma do lie in Mbeki's rule, and Zuma was a reaction to Mbeki, as Ramaphosa is now a reaction to Zuma. This is how politics works in many countries. We should be foolish to think we're different.
Looking at reaction, Stephen, and looking at support for Zuma, I mean, if we, you know, rewind back to that rape trial, that period, I mean, the support around Zuma was incredible.
Yes.
You know, you had Bladen Zamande, Zwelin Zimavave, Julius Malema, Becky Cele, you know, these people who were really vocal. And at that time, you couldn't imagine them, you know, giving up their support for Zuma and actually, you know, calling for him to step down, you know, calling for him to either face the courts. How did that happen?
Yeah. You know, the Zuma rape trial in 2006 was actually much bigger than the Oscar Pistorius trial for its time. The difference was Twitter and email. You didn't have it then. And so, you know, news stations, I mean, you didn't have televised trials, but the judgment was televised. I think it was only the second. The first judgment to be televised was actually the Sheikh judgment. So Zuma, you know, is involved in all of these dynamics. What's happened over time is that Zuma has a long history of casting people aside. So people get thrown overboard by him when he needs to jettison them, or when he can just live without them, he did. I mean, Judge John Thorpe, you know, went too far in the Constitutional Court and tried to influence judges from the evidence that we've seen. And Zuma never lifted a finger to help him. And I think there's a long track record of people who have literally bear the footprints of Zuma on their face. He's trod all over them. Bladen Zamande, Zwelin Zimavavi are the obvious ones. But so are COSATU and the SACP as whole structures. It's been fascinating to watch how certain provinces back Zuma so strongly and don't seem to anymore. So there's all of that. I think what it boils down to is that firstly, the longer you are in government and in power, the more enemies you actually breed, essentially. You get more and more enemies over time, you just do. And secondly, he's never shown any interest or in looking after people. You know, when Ramaphosa quietens a crowd that's shouting boo to Zuma, he's doing something we haven't seen for 10 years. Zuma never stepped in to help anyone. There's something else about Zuma that's almost the most sinister, is that when people have said kill for Zuma, or when people have said that we're throwing a petrol bomb or we're going to take a gun to another political leader's house to defend Zuma, Zuma has never, ever spoken out against them. He's never said not in my name. And that, perhaps, is the most revealing aspect of his rule.
Stephen, how strong is Zuma the man, even within the ANC, no longer president of the country, no longer president of the party, but how strong is he? We saw him pushing the ANC, pushing Cyril Ramaphosa to the brink, you know, before being recalled. How strong is he actually?
So, I think like many people, once you lose just a little bit of your power, you're over. And the video that you will have seen, the ENCA video of Zuma watching the announcements of the ANC results at Nasrec, I think tells you everything. I think what that shows you is a man losing power and being surprised by it, not actually being sure up until that moment it was going to happen. And that, of course, has allowed everything that's followed. I think that while there will be wild talk of people in KwaZulu-Natal this or certain factions that, I don't think any of it's possible. Once you lose state power, you are finished. And it's, you know, looking for people who supported Zuma really is going to be looking for white people who supported the National Party. You're not going to see them.
Stephen, finally, looking at Zuma the man, the presidency or any presidency, you know, being in office for almost 10 years can take its toll on you and does in most instances. But Zuma's personal life has also played out for us to see. Over the years of you covering him, how has Zuma the man changed?
So, you know, the first time I shook hands with him would have been in the Pietermaritzburg High Court in 2005 during one of his court cases. I've had several meals with him back in those times. So, I mean, I'm sure I can betray the confidence now, but just before the elections, there was a dinner. You know, and there were one or two other meals that other journalists would have been a part of. None of this was really secret. And he was very charming. He was interesting. He was funny. He has very interesting stories to tell about the ANC, and that's always been his happy place, is the past and the ANC. You know, for a long time now, the ANC has been far happier in the past than the present. And And in those days, you could almost feel, gosh, things are really going to change. I remember when he and Matthews Pauser, before the 2009 elections, went to an Afrikaans organization and probably had about half of them voting for him at the end of it. That is unthinkable now. I don't think Zuma could go to a group, an ANC regional conference in the Eastern Cape and not face some kind of political backlash. He looks older, obviously. He looks slightly more drawn. It is difficult to kind of disentangle how someone looks from how you are thinking about them. You could be very careful of that. But certainly, I think the years have taken their toll, as they do on all political leaders who've been in high office for 10 years. Certainly, he looks more drawn and just simply wary. How he actually feels, though, of course, is very different. We know, it seems, that he was, you know, there was an attempt to poison him by one of his wives. I do think all of this has taken a toll, but Zuma at his core, at his heart, is a fighter. He literally has always been the last batsman against the best bowler in the world praying for rain.
Have we seen the last of him?
Yes, probably. I think as Zuma loses state power, I think that is the end. I don't think people will look at him in the same way. I think that much of society doesn't just want justice, they almost want revenge, which is actually quite a scary thing. It's an understandable thing, but revenge is not necessarily a wise thing, but I think there will be that thirst for it. So I think so. And also, when you're yesterday's man, you're yesterday's man. No one cares. People are going to look to the future.
People are going to look to the future, and that certainly will be on Jacob Zuma's mind. What does his future hold? The lights have dimmed on his presidential term in office. There are the prospects of criminal charges, but that was Zuma the man. Stephen Grootes, thank you for your analysis.
Thank you. Anytime.